Hi everyone, happy Monday. It's a gorgeous day here. It's probably in the mid-70s or so, supposed to get up to about 80 today. So it's gonna be wonderful. Today's gonna be a fun live stream. We're talking about money saving tips in the garden. So, you know, these days who can't, you know, handle saving a little bit of money right now? It's gonna go over some of my favorite ones that I've been doing lately, but get yours ready because we can all use more ideas on that. So it's great to have you here. Jerry is actually not here today. He's up at jury duty. So waiting to hear if he gets, you know, has to stay for a trial or what have you. I don't know if he's going to be able to watch from his phone or not. It depends on what's going on there up at the government center. But it's great to be here. Great to see all you all here. Hope you had a wonderful weekend. And hello to Debbie. Always great to see you here along with 808 Ladybugs over in Hawaii. Aloha. Hope you're having a great day. I know you've been getting a lot of rain over there. Florence, hello. Always good to see you. Ultimate Gardening. Hi, how are you doing? Reading with Mama. Yes, it is a great topic for today. Sandra Pina, how are you doing today? Connie Graham, never grown parsnips? I never have either, Connie. So maybe we'll have to do that together this year. Hope everything is going well for you. Nisha and Cliff, our moderators, are here. And there's just a lot of people here in the chat. And hope you guys had a beautiful weekend. We have been cool and cloudy now for probably about 5 days, except for today it's nice and sunny. So it's really been nice to have a cool down. I think all the heat came while we were gone for that month in Hawaii. And now it's definitely cooling down, although I must say, of course, it always happens. As soon as I get some cool weather veggies planted, we planted some last week. You saw our winter greens video. We did some peas last week. And of course, tomorrow, guess what it's supposed to be? 90 degrees. So hopefully that will be the last hurrah, but I will be covering some things up with shade cloth. Crazy. Here it is, the end of October, but pretty typical for a southern climate. So let me know if you're heating up in your neck of the woods or cooling down. I know some folks have already had light frosts. I don't know if there's been any hard freezes anywhere, but hopefully things are cooling down. Of course, Murphy's Law, right? And we can get our cool weather veggies out. So let's jump into the tips here, you guys, for money saving in the garden. It definitely is possible to do gardening on the cheap. And like I mentioned earlier, you know, things are just skyrocketing right now. A lot of us are feeling the pinch in our wallets. Gas prices are crazy. Grocery prices are crazy. Everything's going up. So wherever we can cut costs is super, super helpful. And we're always looking here in our family on ways that we can cut back. And of course, one of the biggest ways we cut back is by growing all of our own produce. I never buy produce at the grocery store. Aside from avocados, I don't have an avocado tree, which I probably should get one planted. Avocados, and we do, oops, sorry, something just fell here. Oh, okay. We do buy a lot of lemons because we use a lot of lemons and citrus. I just don't have enough for my lemon tree. But other than that, we buy zero produce at the grocery store. So definitely growing your own food is a very important skill to know these days because you never know when we might have to depend on it. I mean, right now we can still get food from the grocery store and all that, but you never know. So that's what we're all about here at CaliKim, is just teaching you how to grow your own food, how to harvest it, how to eat it. Keeping it quick, simple, and inexpensive is what we're all about. So, and I just see Debbie, first snow to 90 degree temps. Yeah, yeah, no, not you, Debbie. I don't think you're getting a snow there in Hawaii, but yeah, people are crazy weather swings all over the U.S. Just weird temperatures all the way around this year, right? Okay, so one of my very favorite ways to cut costs, because we love salads at our house. And you know, salad greens, especially the organic, like specialty green items, can get so expensive in the stores. Microgreens are super expensive. In fact, I was at a farmer's market a few weeks ago, checking things out there, picking up some lemons and things like that. I just wanted to stop by and take a look at how their produce looked. I looked at their microgreens. Would you believe microgreens, they're cost $7 an ounce. I could not believe it. When you can grow your own little pot of microgreens for practically pennies. In fact, I was gonna show you guys this. Well, let me back up. My first money-saving tip is grow your own gourmet salad greens, or just your own salad greens, period. And you're gonna save a ton of money, especially if you like salads, like greens, which most of us gardeners do. You are gonna save so much money. So this little thing of microgreens here, these are radish microgreens. If you guys saw our video yesterday, we did a quick little 3-minute video. I showed you guys some of the micros that I'm growing. These are radishes, and these were planted 1 week ago today. So look at this. I'm already harvesting my own microgreens. They cost pennies to grow. And we harvested a bunch of microgreens from this little pot yesterday and just threw them right on our scrambled eggs. So for microgreens, I like to harvest them as I use them just have them fresh. But $7 an ounce at the market for these things. Can you believe it? And you can literally plant them for pennies. So we did a little video last week on growing winter greens. Winter salad greens. So you southern gardeners, do make sure you watch that video, because in the south here, like in Southern California, some of you milder winter climates, you can grow greens all winter long. It's the best time of year to grow them. Nice and cool. Greens that won't thrive in the hot months will thrive in the winter here. So do make sure that you plant your own salad greens and save a ton of money. I mean, for my microgreen seed collection, I think it's around 10-ish so dollars, but you get 8 or 9 seed packets, and you can grow pots and pots of microgreens for absolutely pennies. And your gourmet salad greens are gonna be super, super tasty and fresh, colorful. One of my favorites is endive, and oh my gosh, I absolutely love it. It's ruffly, it's beautiful. So not only do you get the joy of growing your own, but you get to come out and harvest it, and then we always have plenty that we can give away and share with people, and you're saving a ton of money. So if you've never grown anything before and want to save money in your garden, greens are a great way to start. They're one of the easiest things you can grow. You can plant them in small little containers like I have back here. I've got a little container of lettuce going here, which you can grow indoors. So pretty much wherever you're at, you can grow greens inside or outside in the winter and save yourself some money. So those of you that are getting snow and getting frost, don't think that that lets you off the hook for growing things, because you can grow them all winter long under grow lights, or even your microgreens, you can just grow right on your countertop. So save a ton of money and grow your own greens in the wintertime. Now, speaking of that, don't forget to head over to CaliKimGardeningHome.com. We have a great deal going on. Today is the very last day for it. You can get 20% off everything. Just use the code GROWFOOD. But what's fun about this sale is that you're going to get a free 1-gallon Smart Pots just like this. You can get your greens planted, get your microgreens planted. I just wanted to give you guys the opportunity to get some things planted right away. So we're throwing in a little freebie with your order. Never done that before. This is actually a $9 value for this pot. So just to encourage you to get some greens planted, because we're all about growing food. I want everyone to be able to grow and have the tools you need to do that. So go over to CaliKimGardeningHome.com, grab your seed collections, and you'll get a free Smart Pots with every single order. We are running just a little bit low on the 1 gallon. So if you're going to place your order, I would encourage you to do it as soon as possible, even during the live stream, because I don't want you to miss out. Okay, so tip number one, grow your own greens all winter long. I want to hear now in the chat what your ideas are for saving money, and then we'll jump back into another one of my favorite tips after we look at the chat here for a minute. Okay, V, I can't wait to use it in my kitchen window. Yeah, I got your order there, V. And either was it sent out Friday or Saturday? I can't remember, but you should be getting it soon. And you can pop it there on your countertop. The colors are really fun. Make a nice little color pop in the house there. Okay, Debbie Delano. Hi, how are you, Debbie? I have a question. If my cucumbers had aphids, how do we prepare it to use again for winter? Okay, so depending on where you live, I know even if you live in a southern climate, cucumbers do not grow well in the wintertime. They're a warm weather vegetable. Now, if you're way far south, like, you know, maybe in Hawaii or something like that, where it's super warm all winter long, you can do that. But to get rid of cucumbers, or not to get rid of cucumbers, to get rid of aphids, what I always do first is spray off my plant to get all the aphids off as much as I can. And then I will usually do that for a couple of days to see if the aphids will go away. If not, not, I'll spray them with neem oil. And you can watch my organic pest control video for all the details on how to do that. But it does need to be done about every 3 days if there's an infestation. And then you can also spray the soil to get rid of aphids in the soil. So if that's maybe your question is, how do I prepare the soil to grow again in wintertime? I would definitely treat the soil too with neem oil do that maybe for a week or two to really get rid of it every, 3 to 5 days. Check and see if you have any more aphids, add some extra potting mix to your container or your raised bed, and you should be good to go with planting for the next go around. But cucumbers like the warm temperature, so they're not going to grow well when the temperatures dip down, like in the 50s, the 40s, definitely not into the 30s. They definitely won't take a frost. So just keep that in mind and make it easy on yourself and plant yourself some cool weather greens here in the winter. Okay, Urban Chicken Mama, great tip there for saving money. Save seeds, freeze, can, DIY garden things, absolutely. So right now, when you might have a big abundance of things in your garden, now's the time to take advantage of that and save on your grocery bill by popping some of those things in the freezer, saving your seeds for next year so you don't have to, so you have free seeds and free plants for next year. Dehydrating, if you have a dehydrator, and canning, which is not my forte, I tend to do more freezing, but if you love to can, absolutely, now's the time to take advantage of that. Now, right now I have tons and tons of basil in the garden. I don't think I've ever had this much basil before. So I'm gonna be making some pesto and freezing that in ice cube trays, and hopefully maybe doing a video on that this week. So let me know here in the chat if you'd like to see a video on pesto. It's delicious, and then it's so much fun to pull out in the wintertime, have that fresh pesto. I may make some tonight and cook up some chicken with pesto on top of it, or use it for a pizza crust, pizza sauce, spread it on your homemade pizzas, whatever. It's a great thing to do. Okay, let's see here. That's the question there, pretty much dead. Okay, yeah, I would totally go ahead and pull out your cucumbers, Debbie. They're probably not going to revive in time for the winter. And again, unless you live in a tropical climate, you're probably not going to be able to grow them over the winter. It's just going to be too cold. So just plant some other vegetables. Peas would be great. So make sure that you check out my video on peas. Okay, great idea. V says, I've been saving seeds. Don't have to buy so often, but I still love to receive seeds in the mail. I think us gardeners, V, are all seed addicts. I know for me, I'm constantly figuring out what I can plant that's new, as well as saving seeds in the garden as well. So that's always a lot of fun. What I like to do sometimes too, to help save money, this isn't really a tip, just a little side note about saving seeds, is, for example, when my beans dry on the vine, or my basil flowers dry up, instead of like taking the seeds inside, I'll just kind of crumble them into the soil right where they're at, and that way it saves me time and saves me money at the same time. It might not quite be warm enough for them to sprout right away, but at some point in the future, sometimes those seeds generally do come up. Okay, yes, so addicted with seeds, Nisha, I totally hear you on that one. And DC says, would love to see the pesto making. I have tons of basil right now. Okay, so maybe that's what we'll do for our video tomorrow. We've been filming on Tuesday mornings and then uploading at some point Tuesday or Wednesday morning. So maybe that's what I'll do for our video tomorrow, if a lot of people are interested in that. And just so you guys know, kind of generally, we've got our Monday live streams. We've been trying to do a Tuesday, Wednesday morning upload, so be watching for that. And then a Thursday afternoon or a Friday morning upload. So definitely be watching for those too. And then we're trying to do more shorter content videos like we did yesterday, just kind of what I'm doing in the garden, because a lot of people maybe don't have time to watch a 10 or 12 minute video, but they might have time to watch a 3 minute video. So if you have any ideas for things you'd like to see videos on, pop them in the chat, drop me a comment on Instagram, or send me an email. We always welcome new ideas for things that you all would like to see videos on. Okay, so let's talk about my next money-saving tip here. And that is, I think someone mentioned that, is make your own soil. Okay, you can save so much money when you make your own soil. Soil is by far the biggest investment that you're going to make in the garden. As a lot of you well know, soil is very, very expensive. So if you buy the bagged mix at the garden center, you are going to be spending a ton of soil. And sometimes you need to do that just for convenience sake, or maybe you just don't want to make your own soil, which is absolutely fine. The bagged garden soil is perfectly okay, but you can save a lot of money by making your own. And I actually just made a little playlist on all the soil making videos that I have. And that'll be in the video description, and Nisha Cliff will also pop that here in the chat. And you can also go on our channel and the little magnifying glass search. You can type in DIY soil or any topic that you have a question on. It'll pull up those videos so you know exactly what to do. But if you watched our whole raised bed series this year, we did a whole video on making your own soil for a raised bed. I also have, just dropped it here, but in my book here, Raised Bed Gardening, I've got a whole section on filling your raised bed for cheap and several DIY soil recipes. So especially when you're filling several beds or several containers. Oops, the link didn't come through. Okay, sorry about that. Anyway, you can find the playlist on in the video description or on our YouTube channel. Just search soil. But anyway, there's a whole chapter here on filling your raised beds for cheap, different methods for filling them, as well as different soil recipes. So depending on your time, depending on your budget, depending on the materials you have available, you can grab a copy of my book over at CaliKimGardenHome.com and have those available to you. Now, we have been making our own seed starting mix pretty much exclusively this year and save so much money. And I absolutely love it. It's a really nice fine mix. We have a video on how to do this as well. But basically it's just coco coir, which you can get over on Amazon. It's Vermisteria worm castings and vermiculite. So typically what we'll do is we make up a big bin of this. I keep it in the garage because a lot of times when I start my seeds indoors, I don't want to risk, you know, having it outside and then bringing it inside and bringing bugs inside. So I keep it in the garage. And then whenever we start seeds in the little 6-pack seed cells, we have it ready and made. Might need to just moisten it up a little bit. And it makes just starting seeds so quick and so easy, and it saves a ton of money. So the worm castings in here are a great little boost. As your seedlings get just a little bit bigger, it feeds them and really keeps them going. And a lot of people ask me, why do your seedlings grow so fast? Why do they look so good? Mine don't look so good. It seriously is because of the Vermisteria products that I use, the worm castings in the seed starting mix, which is all right here in the 6-packs. And then I fertilize with the Vitality, which just works wonders for seedlings. It really helps with their root development. These are some of the greens from my new specialty green seed collection. And this whole tray was started the 18th, I believe, of September. So we were gone, our friend Dana started all these seeds for me, and we're gonna be planting them out. I'm gonna wait till after the 90 degree day, but aren't these beautiful? The KX Kale is so pretty. The Tatsoi is one of my favorites right here, the red mustard greens. These are all greens from my seed collections that will be growing in our garden all winter long. So definitely by using your own soil or making your own soil, you can save hundreds of dollars for your raised beds. I do have a recipe also for potting mix and then the seed starting mix. So let me know here in the chat if you've got a favorite soil recipe or if you like to make your soil as well. We'd love to hear more about it as well as some more of your money saving tips. Okay, so let's head here in the chat. And all the ratios, by the way, are in those videos too. So that you have everything what you need. I have links in those videos for supplies that you might need, as well as some discounts. Like over on Vermisteria, you can get a discount with my code CaliKim. It's a 10% discount. Okay, Kim P, how are you? Great to see you here. Afternoon, CaliKim and the entire chat crew from hot and sunny British Virgin Islands. So Kim, you're probably one of those that could grow cucumbers in the winter time. Someone was asking a little bit earlier about that. So being where you're at, I bet you grow a lot of fun stuff in the winter. Okay, Sharmak, hi, how are you? I used your seed starting recipe this year. It worked so well. I'm so glad it's worked well for you. Yeah, I absolutely love it. And we just always have the supplies for it around because we're always starting some seeds. Usually every week we start seeds here. Okay, Ramona, how are you, Ramona? Great to see you today. Canning is so fun. I started doing it during COVID. Now I can so much. I am just going to make apple butter for the first time. I'm cheering you on. Wow, that's awesome. Sharmak, delving into canning there, getting some encouragement from Ramona. And you know, I think a lot of people started canning and gardening and all those kinds of things during COVID because, you know, people were home and needed things to do. But it's a great chance to make good use of what you're growing outside to preserve it in some way. So thanks for that encouragement. That's one thing I love about this, this group here in the chat, our community here at CaliKim, is people are just so kind. I think gardeners are probably some of the nicest people in the world, and we encourage each other and support each other, cheer each other on, and just encourage each other to grow our own food, which, you know, that's what it's all about. 808 Ladybug loves the seed starting mix, but having trouble getting vermiculite. Can I use finer perlite? You know what? You definitely can use perlite. Vermiculite is available on Amazon. I don't know how things work with shipments to you from Amazon. Got my Amazon link down below. Perlite does tend to dry out just a little bit more. I personally prefer vermiculite just because I like the soil to stay damp a little bit longer. In your situation, depending on where you're growing 808 Ladybug, I know you get tons of rain there. You're a little bit more humid there in Hawaii. So perlite could possibly work just as fine for you. What was I gonna say here? Perlite a lot of times is used in like a succulent mix or things like that, that it doesn't really matter so much if they dry out. So that's kind of the difference between the two. There's also, I explain the differences between the two in my book. I know you do have my book, 808 Ladybug, so check that out and maybe that'll clear up that question for you there. Okay, let's talk about the next little tip here to save money in the winter. And this is one of my favorite things to do. I love to pass this on to friends as well, and that is propagate your herbs. Okay, we all know how expensive herbs are at the grocery store, and they usually come in a small little, you know, a pack of some kind, a little plastic bag, or, you know, maybe you can pick them up from the produce section, but they don't stay fresh very long. They tend to get slimy. And you know, you only use a few herbs at once for the most part. So a lot of times they don't last long, and then you're left with spending $5 for a little bundle of herbs and then them not even lasting. But they're so easy to propagate, you guys. So right now, if you still have tons of basil in your garden, if you're in a warm climate and your basil hasn't died off yet, and this I just brought outside, so it's getting a little bit wilted out here in the heat. Propagate your herbs, which just means that you're rooting your herb cuttings. You're taking cuttings from your garden, you're putting them in water, and I always pop in a little bit of either the Vermistera worm tea or the Vitality in here because it has a natural root hormone and they root so much quicker. So these are beautiful little containers of herbs, jars of herbs that have been cut from my garden. They've been inside on my countertop for a couple of days. My daughter actually is really getting into plants. She's never really enjoyed growing before, but I brought her up some herbs a few weeks ago and she wanted some more. So I popped these in a jar for her and now she's giving them away to friends as gifts and that kind of thing. But you can grow these once they root. You can pop them in a little container of soil. It makes great gifts. And yeah, Urban Chicken Mama, dehydrate your herbs to make them last. Great idea on that as well. You can pop them in a little container, a little smart pots or so after they grow roots. And you can have herbs inside during the winter time when they might not make it outside. Now basil is very cold sensitive. So here, once it dips, you know, in the 40s at night, most of my Italian large leaf basil will not make it. The Thai basil does pretty well in the winter. And the mint will do well in the winter here as well. But in some climates, it's not gonna do well. So go ahead and do that. You're gonna save a ton of money. Not to mention that, if you are, I know, you know what? That's the way I say herbs. Some people say it differently, but that's just how I do it. So if you say it a different way, all that, more power to you, okay? Now, if you want to grow inside, it's super easy to grow them in the smart pot. So indoor gardens here we come. And you know what? Even if I have them growing outside, it's really fun to have them growing indoors on the countertop, because when I'm cooking, I'm a lot more likely to grab a few snips of basil or my dill or my chives is what I usually grow indoors than I am to run out to the garden and grab it. So it just makes it quick to grab. And of course, you're gonna save so much money doing that. And if you have an abundance, it's a great thing to be able to share with your friends as well. So save money by growing your own greens, save money by propagating your herbs. I mean, you can't beat free plants, right? And that will you're well on your way to growing your own food and cutting back on your grocery bill. Okay, let's hear some more tips in the chat here on how you are saving money in your garden. Okay, let's see here. Lots of canning. Okay, Debbie, you've gotten a vermiculite on Amazon, but isn't always available. So yeah, sometimes when I've ordered from Amazon, I always try and order the small vermiculite, but a couple times they have sent me little or bigger chunks of vermiculite. So sometimes they kind of switch things around there on Amazon. So the smaller, larger chunks actually work just fine as well. But I prefer the smaller ones just for a finer seed starting mix. So good luck with getting that. And maybe your local garden centers would have some also. Okay, can you show us your indoor plants and herbs from Marie? Faulkner, I'm not sure if I'm saying that correctly. You know what, check the video we posted yesterday. I did show a lot of those on that video, and that was all about how anyone can grow veggies no matter where you live. There's something you can grow right now, whether you're in a cold climate, you can grow indoors, and I talked about that on that video. It's a quick 3-minute video, so go over and give that a look. I also showed some of the pots that are actually right back here that I'll be growing indoors under grow light, so definitely check that out. And Jeremy says, what herbs can you propagate? Definitely mint and basil are two of the easiest ones. You can also propagate rosemary, oregano, thyme. I don't know if I'm forgetting some, but those are the main ones that can be propagated. And go and check out my videos on propagating herbs. Just type in herbs in our the search field on our YouTube channel, and a whole bunch of videos will pop up on how to do that. Okay, thank you so much, Cliff, how to propagate herbs for an endless supply. We've got tons of videos there, at least several. I don't know about tons, but 3 or 4 at least. Jackie says, I reuse my pots and my soil. And I'm so glad that you brought that up, Jackie. I meant to mention that with the DIY making your own soil. And that is, a lot of people ask me, one of the questions I get asked the most is, can I reuse my soil? And you absolutely can. Again, soil is a huge investment. Definitely don't want to be dumping out your potting mix unless there's some kind of terrible infestation in it, like a terrible fungus or lots and lots of bugs. All you have to do is add a couple inches of fresh potting mix to your containers, mix it in. I have lots of videos on how to do that. And you want to top off your raised beds when you replant, add additional nutrients. I showed how to do that on last week's video on growing winter greens. But you just want to be replenishing your soil and even add things over the winter time to it to help it, all the organic matter break down over the winter time. Definitely soil and reuse your containers. And by the way, you guys, the smart pots, I know a lot of you use smart pots. Here's another one growing for my indoor garden, the tiny tomato, which is in my indoor garden seed collection as well. A lot of you are growing with smart pots, and I washed a whole washer full of smart pots last week. I rinsed them out outdoors first. The ones that are empty, I rinsed out the extra soil. I threw in my washers, tons of the 1 gallon, a whole bunch of black 5 gallons, even the 10 gallon pots, and like the purple mini raised beds. I threw them in my washer, and then once I pulled them out, I just air dried them, and they literally came out looking like new. That's super durable fabric, and if they get a little bit dirty or, like here, there's some dirt and things on it. Throw them in there if that bothers you, and they'll come out looking like new. So definitely reuse your pots and reuse your soil as much as you possibly can. Let's see, Luane, I'm sorry, my iPad is dimming, so I'm having a hard time seeing the names here. When do I plant my thyme seeds in Central Cali. You can definitely plant those right now. Typically people will plant thyme about 8 weeks before your last frost date, but here in California, we don't get much of a frost. You might get a frost there in Central Cali, but definitely start your thyme seeds. They are a little bit difficult to germinate, so just be aware of that. They can take, you know, 8 to 10 weeks to really get to size to place out in your garden. That's a great way to get your herbs going a lot less expensively as is starting them from seed. Okay, any other comments here in the chat? Irene, great comment there. I don't have a dehydrator. I hung them and let them dry by themselves. So yeah, that's a great way to let things dry if you don't have a dehydrator. I don't have one either. And that's typically what I'll do is I'll just tie a little piece of twine around the stems, kind of hang them upside down like over a nail in the kitchen or a little hook somewhere and let them dehydrate naturally. You can also put your oven on like warmish temp, very low temperature. Keep an eye on them though, because they burn really fast, and let them dehydrate that way. Okay, thank you so much for the tips. You are so helpful and we appreciate it so much. Thank you. Really nice to hear that. Thank you so much for your kind words. We love what we do here and it really makes us feel good to be able to help other people with what we really enjoy doing. Okay, let me talk about tip number four. And then we'll have some time to answer questions and comments before the live stream ends today. And I also want to hear more of your tips here in the chat. Oh, great idea. I see here Patricia said a couple of local gardeners and I swap seeds and plants. That's a great way to save money. I mean, we all have way too many seeds, right? But it's a good thing. Maybe you buy, you know, one kind of tomato, someone else buys another, and you can trade half the seeds or the plants with someone else. That's a great idea to be able to really get out there and meet people too, you know, in your community, maybe your neighbors that you'd like to share those things with. It's really, really fun. Okay, so one of the great tips to save money, one of my favorite all-time tips, and it's free and it helps your garden so much, is save your leaves, okay? Completely free resource that you can amend your garden beds with, and just, you know, go around and ask your neighbors. A lot of times people will throw them away, put them out with the trash, and just ask them to save them for you. Maybe you can give them a bin to put them in after they are done raking them up, and then you can, you know, empty it out in your house or a big pile in your yard and then bring the bin back to them. But some people, it's a nuisance to have so many leaves, but it's garden gold. I mean, make a big pile in the corner of your and let them pile up over winter time. As it rains, as it snows, they're going to break down and make leaf mold, which is great for your garden. Basically like making, you know, a type of compost in your garden. I've got a big 100-gallon compost sack where I put all of mine in. Once the winds start, we get tons of leaves falling off the trees. My neighbor has way more than he can use, even though he's got a compost pile. So I'm always grabbing the ones that he doesn't need. And I think I'm just now running out of leaves that I saved from last year. So it really does help your garden a ton. In the winter time, if you can mulch your garden beds, your empty gardens with your leaves, it'll break down over the winter and your soil will be nice and fertile. Spring, the worms will come in. You won't have to spend near as much on soil. Whether you're making your own soil or purchasing soil, it's going to save you a ton of money. So everything in my garden gets mulched, whether it be with leaves or shredded straw, but they come in so handy. And when you get to build a compost pile, I always add in a ton of leaves that really help that compost pile heat up and bulk up, so you can get tons and tons of free fertilizer and free compost for your garden. So one of the biggest money saving things you can do is save your leaves. We even used to go to a park down the street and bring black garbage bags and just, where there's tons of trees down there, and just fill the garbage bags as full of leaves as we could get and bring them back and just save the black, you know, garbage bags on the side of the house for when I need them for compost. So we don't do that so much anymore because I've been collecting them from neighbors and friends and things like that. But if you have a park nearby you, you might want to do that as well. Now, if you live like in a patio or an apartment or, you know, a condo that have a small space to garden in, You might just want to get, like, Smart Pots does have those 100-gallon compost sacks, and I think they are going to be coming out with a 50-gallon smaller ones before too much longer. So you can still compost in a small space, but those are super handy for filling up with all of your fall leaves. So great, great way to save money in the garden. Okay, lots and lots of people out there getting excited about saving your leaves. So yeah, there's tons of resources there for you. And Jill, great question here. Do you mulch over freshly planted seeds? Yes, I do. What I like to do though is make sure that it's shredded up leaves. So, and I will just kind of sprinkle them kind of lightly over freshly planted seeds. I show that in a lot of my videos. And then as the seeds start to germinate and grow and the plants get a little bit bigger, I'll put some more mulch around the base of the plants, either to protect them from the cold in the wintertime, depending on the vegetables, or from the heat in the summertime. So just go a little bit lighter on those freshly planted seeds, just so you're not like inhibiting the germination. You know, they don't have too much of a heavy covering when they're trying to germinate. And Ramona, Charmac 76, I thought I was the only one who got excited about collecting leaves this year. Yeah, I think a lot of us gardeners do get pretty excited about that. It's pretty funny how the things that we get excited about, right? Okay, lots of, yeah, we do have lots of great compost videos. We have a whole compost playlist. So again, just search on our channel for compost, and just about any way you want to make compost, we've got a video on, whether it's hot compost, cold compost, whether you're composting in a compost sack, a Smart Pots compost sack, whether you want to build your own bin, even the 5-gallon CaliKim Smart Pots you can compost in a small space. So no matter how much or how little space you have, or what type of compost you want to make or build, what kind of pile you want to build, there's a video out there for you. Okay, do you use mulch on inside growing? Patricia, no, I don't. There's really no need to do that, in my opinion, because the main purpose for mulch, at least outside, is for it to break down into your soil, for it to protect from heat, protect from cold, and to help with water retention. And I don't really need that in my inside garden. It would take a long, long time for leaves to break down in an inside garden. It just doesn't have the elements to be able to do that. And I don't want to bring leaves into the inside garden because they might have bugs or whatever on them. But even like clean straw, I use a lot of the clean straw. I just generally don't do that indoors. So really not necessary. It is a personal preference. I know some people will cover the tops of their soil inside with like sand or vermiculite or perlite to help with the fungus gnats. So that is definitely an option, but mulch really isn't necessary in the indoor garden. Okay, Jackie, how you doing, Jackie? How's it going? We lost all of our leaves in the summer here in Oklahoma. We got very little rain. Could I enrich my soil with worm castings? Absolutely. It's not gonna be like the mulch type of situation that you would have with leaves, but worm castings do aerate your soil. They help with the soil structure, as well as feed your soil. You know, worms are so good for your soil, and the worm castings have so much of that beneficial bacteria and microbes that I always talk about. So yeah, I pretty much add worm castings whenever I plant anything, whether in containers, indoors, outdoors. We use it for just about everything because I get such good results with that. So yeah, definitely check out the worm castings over at Vermistera. Okay, Sally, how you doing? I spent a small fortune on an outdoor large compost tumbler, and the first season a tree fell on it. Oh my goodness, that's terrible. I'm so sorry to hear that. The compost tumblers do work well because they're a closed system. So if you have you know, like a rodent problem, that works great, but they can be a little bit pricey. So sorry about that. The compost sacks also work great because they have a cover on them. So even if you have like a rat or a mice problem, they have a cover on them. They definitely help keep the rodents out, and they keep the heat in. If you're, you know, hot composting, it comes with a fitted cover. It kind of looks like a big hat that you put over your compost sack, and it really definitely does help with that. Okay, a famous local gardener in Seattle says aphids don't like the beach, so put sand on top of your indoor plants. Okay, wonder who that famous Seattle gardener is. So thanks a lot, Urban Chicken Mama, for sharing that with us. Yeah, that does work really well. Just make sure you get clean sand. You know, don't just go out to your kid's sandbox outside and grab some sand. Make sure it's clean, get it straight from a garden center, or make sure it's sterilized so you're not bringing any of those pests inside. Because once you get them indoors, it's really hard to get rid of them. There's no natural predators inside. So do everything you can to prevent them. Okay, Wanda, are oak leaves and magnolia leaves okay to use? They are quite thick. Gosh, there is one type of leaf that is not a great mulch. I'm trying to remember what kind it is. I don't think it's oak. The magnolia leaves, we have a magnolia tree and I use them all the time. They fall, you know, right under our tree over here, and I just grab them and throw them in my garden beds. I don't tend to use those on, Mac is biting the bees. Mac, you're gonna get stung if you do that, buddy. I don't tend to use those on my freshly planted little seeds unless I shred them up, which I don't normally do. I just don't usually take the time to do that. I just pick them up off the ground and throw them on my garden bed, which is nearby. But you can shred up your leaves, and an easy way to do that is by just running them over with a lawnmower. If you have a lot of leaves, you know, rake them up, run them over with a lawnmower, and then throw them into a compost sack or a trash can for later use. But yeah, I don't see a problem. The magnolia leaves have been just fine. Okay, let's see. Any other questions here in the chat before we sign off? Your gardening with Cisco. Thank you so much for popping that there in the chat, Urban Chicken Mama. Appreciate that. And Mary Lou says, I grew strawberries for the first time here in San Francisco, and it's so amazing. Have lots of runners now trying to propagate in water. I need advice on when to transplant them in soil. Okay, great thing to do also to save money in the garden is to propagate anything else that will propagate in your garden, such as strawberries, root very, very easily. Now, what you can do, Mary Lou, rather than rooting them in water, I've actually never done them in water before. I usually just do them right into soil because they root very easily. So if you already have strawberries growing, all you need to do is poke those little roots right into the ground or into another little spot of soil. Like maybe you have them in a container and the runners are going everywhere. Just put another container, or I've even done it in these little CaliKim 1 gallons, is put a little container right next to your container of strawberries, bring the runner over, pop it in the container of soil. You can clip it in there with like a little landscape staple or a bobby pin so it doesn't pop out. And then maybe in a week or two, once it kind of gives a little bit of resistance when you tug it, it's rooted, it's established, and then you can cut it from the mother plant. So just kind of keep an eye on it and keep giving it a small little tug, and once it, you know, is a little bit hard to pull, that means your roots are getting more established. So that's a great way to get lots of free strawberry plants. I'm sure it probably does work in water as well, but normally I just keep it easy and just pop them right in a little thing of soil right next to where they're already growing, and it just, you know, saves you time in the garden, which we all can you know, save a little bit more time in the garden too. Jackie Perez, question is, can we put fresh cut grass in the mulch pile? Yes, you can. I prefer to put mine in my compost, and I'll tell you why. A lot of times there's weed seeds in my grass. Our grass is pretty weedy here. It's not perfect or beautiful grass or anything like that. And I really don't want to put it in the mulch because, you know, then it's going to spread to my garden. So what I tend to do is save my grass clippings for my hot compost pile, because in a hot compost pile, it's going to heat up. It's going to kill any of the viable weed seeds or any other viable seeds in it. And that way I'm not spreading that and risking spreading weeds around to the rest of my garden. And you also want to make sure if you do that, that you're not spraying your lawn with any, if you're growing organic, that you're not spraying your lawn with any chemical pesticides. Because then if you put your grass clippings in the compost or in your mulch, you're obviously going to be spreading that to the rest of your garden. So just keep that in mind when it comes to grass clippings. But I think one of my most popular videos, I think it's been viewed maybe 1.4 million times, you'll see it first on our YouTube channel with popular uploads, is about hot composting with grass clippings. And we posted that one years ago, but yeah, it definitely will heat up your compost pile super, super quick. So head over to watch that video if you want to compost with your grass clippings. Okay, let's take one more question here. And this is from Denise. Can you propagate collards? Okay, thank you so much. Also, Terry, don't forget to give the live stream a thumbs up. I appreciate that. Okay, collards, no, as far as I know, I've never tried it, but as far as I know, you cannot propagate collards, but I don't think I have my collard seedlings here, but they grow so easily from seed. So, you know, it's usually not a problem to get those growing super, super fast. The great thing about collards, I thought I had my fall garden seed. Oh, here it is. They're in my fall garden seed collection, by the way. 14 cool other veggies in here. So grab one of these with that Grow Food 20% discount today. They grow so fast. They are one of the most cold tolerant and heat tolerant vegetables you can grow. So a lot of times, even with hard frosts, you can cover them on a hard frost night and they will survive. They survive through the heat, they survive through the cold. They're just crazy, crazy hardy green. So if you're looking for a hardy green, definitely grow the collards. Kale and chard are also super hardy greens to grow. Pretty much good to grow in the heat and in the summertime. So grab those, get those planted. So if you're looking for some good seed collections to grab right now, some of my favorites for this time of the year, just run through these real quick here. A lot of people say, what do I grow right now? I'm not too sure what to grab on your website. And by the way, we are kind of revamping our website to make it easier to find things on there. And hopefully we'll be having something new rolling out later this week. So do keep an eye on that for CaliKimGardenAndHome.com. But a really good one for you Northern gardeners especially is the Indoor Garden Seed Collection. Nine or 10 different varieties of greens, microgreens, and herbs, and the Tiny Tim tomato. So good one for you Northern gardeners. Southern gardeners who can still grow outside, the Fall Garden Seed Collection, 14 varieties. And then of course the specialty greens, which we did a video on these this week. These are just amazing greens like tatsoi, red mustard greens, endive, KX kale, absolutely delicious salads. And then one of my favorites to grow pretty much for anyone right now is the microgreens. So easy to grow. You'll be harvesting little tiny microgreens like this little pot here in about 7 days. That's crazy, crazy fun. So grab all those for 20% off with the code GROWFOOD. Today's the last day of that sale. You get that 1 gallon Smart Pots with your order. And I want to come back next week and see how many of you have gotten some fresh new seeds planted this week. We've got to keep growing our own food, saving money on our grocery bills, and we're having a ton of fun doing it together. So really appreciate you guys joining me today. It's been a lot of fun, and we look forward to seeing you on our videos throughout this week. Make sure you leave us a comment if you watch our videos. Let us know that you're there. Let us know what you liked about the video. Give us a suggestion for some future content. We'd love to hear from you. And we'll look forward to seeing you right back here again next Monday at noon Pacific time. All right, guys, thanks for hanging out today. It's been a ton of fun, and we'll see you later. Bye-bye.